Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble in my drag.
Preaching the gospel. They were abused because they preached the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They were hated because they credited Christ with the power to heal and change lives. They were mocked and humiliated because they proclaimed that salvation was found in the name of Jesus Christ alone. People doubted them for giving true evidence that they had been with Jesus Christ. They suffered threats being faithful followers of Jesus Christ. They were sold out for their love for Christ, and they refused to compromise their message. Their loyalty resulted in all men glorifying God. And we see all these things happening, and as these things were happening, there was a lot of strife because people, they didn't want these people to point anything to Jesus. They wanted everything to be pointed to men. And I believe even this in this generation we see it. People these days, they prophesy or they pray for the sick and they say, look to what I can do, not what God can do. I believe the most important thing is that we should point everything that happens to Jesus. Here's one of the things that I want each and every one of us to remember. What do you do now coming to church? Anything that we do is not important than the soul that you win in the kingdom of God. When we win a soul before Jesus, it changes the entire life of human beings. In my lifetime, I have endeavored that every opportunity, every second, every minute, if I have an opportunity to meet a person, I'll ask them if they know Jesus. It doesn't matter what religion, what faith they come from, but I wear my relationship with Jesus Christ on my shoulders with the pride that Jesus died for me. Many years ago, I was a young man, so zealous for God as I am still right now. I'm still a young man, but a couple of hairs have changed. I've become a little bit gray. But once I color them, you never know what has happened. But many years ago, I was driving with a gentleman. He was my professor in college. And he looked at me with His eyes turned, I thought he was schizophrenic. He could literally see fire. And he said, I have a question to ask you. Now, when you are driving, you have been laughing and everything has been going on. A person just pulls the car on the side of the road. It concerns you. And he pulled the car. He says, why are you a Christian? I looked at him. I said, what kind of a question is that? He says, I want to know why you're a Christian. I said, because Jesus died for me. He says, Jesus died for everybody I know. He says, why are you a Christian and have you decided to be in the full-time ministry? And I said, to win the souls and to bring them to Jesus. And this man, all of a sudden, I saw him trembling and shaking, and the tears started rolling down. He says, David, if I die today, I die tomorrow, I die before you, or you die before me. He says, there's nothing that is more important in this world and that is more powerful. The messages that you preach, they'll be forgotten. Anything that you do, it'll be forgotten. But the soul that you win in the kingdom of God will never be forgotten. And at that moment, as this man was saying, I felt the presence of the Lord. He says, do you realize the joy in heaven over one single soul that becomes saved? And he looked at me. He says, brother, he says, I'm not impressed in the church. I'm impressed in how many people they are going to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And as that moment when he spoke like that, something hit me hard. I started weeping as well. And he says, brother, I wanted to talk to you about that. You're going to church every Sunday. It's little compared to the soul that you bring to the kingdom of God. Today, I want to bring the same challenge to every one of us. Why are you a child of God? Why are you in the house of God this morning? How many people do you see every day that you wonder where they are going? When you look at them, what comes in your heart? Are these people going to make it? One of the ladies that I read in the book by the name of Collie Ten Boom, her and her father, they own a shop in Amsterdam. And every morning they used to leave from their home to the train station to catch the train to go to their little shop where they were selling jewelry. And every morning they could go there. And one day, Colleton turned to his father because they developed a system where they used to protect the Jews when Hitler was killing them. And Colleton turned to his father. He says, Daddy, one day, the Nazis, they'll find out that we are the people who are protecting these Jews. And what are we going to do? And the father turned and looked at Collie. And he says, Collie, when do we buy the ticket when we are going to a shop? He says, when we are at the train station. And the father looked at the daughter. He says, daughter, when these Nazi people, they arrest us, God will provide the grace for us to endure through the trying times. Saints, today I want to encourage each and every one of us. It's important to surrender our lives and surrender everything to Him and say, God, I want souls to be won for Jesus. Amen. People are afraid to support true men and the movement of God because they are thinking, what will people think about me? People are afraid not to rock the boat for the cause of being so sold out for Jesus. Colette and Boone was ready to say, I'm ready to die for him. People that think as long they are not bothering anyone, that's okay, because it makes them good Christians. The thing is that there's no one who is a good Christian. A good Christian disturbs the devil. I wish somebody can hear me. I say a good Christian disturbs the devil. If the devil is not disturbing you, there's something that you are not doing for Jesus. When you are disturbing the devil fights you back. And a lot of Christians, when you look in the Bible, they have been persecuted, they have been tormented, there have been all kinds of things have happened to them because they have stood in for nothing but for Jesus. Our Christianity these days in America is, let me go in a nice church that have air conditions with a nice program, nice everything, and then I'm there, I listen to about 25 to 35 minutes message, then I'm gone home and my ticket is registered. But I want to let you know, in the New Testament, Christianity was, Lord, who is my target to bring in the kingdom of God? And God wants us to win people to the Lord. What was so unique with Peter and John when they credited the power of God to make men whole? The first thing, Peter declared three critical points, and I'm going to share those three critical points. Number one, it was the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that made men whole. The name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth made men what? Whole. And today, it's not how good the preacher is. It's not how good the worship sound is. It's not how good the drums or the tambourines or whatever is in the church is. But it is the name of Jesus. Everybody say the name of Jesus. Number two, it was Jesus the Messiah who was crucified. Remember, at this time, he was speaking to the top leaders of the nation. Peter was speaking to the top leaders of the nation, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, that they knew religion. They had calculated everything. They had studied volumes, commentary about religion. And Peter said, I'm going to change the hearts of the leaders. I want to let you know, as we have the privilege, we need to reach to that point where we speak to those people whom we think they're impossible. There's no one that is impossible before the Lord. Number three, it was Jesus who was raised from the dead and made men whole. There's no other person who was raised from the dead, buried for 3 days and resurrected. Then we saw him walk among men and talk to men, but Jesus alone. So when we begin to realize these facts, things, they change. Acts chapter 1 verse 22 says, the beginning from the baptism of John, that the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. Acts chapter 2 verse 24 also says, but God raised him from the dead. But God raised him from the what? Freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. It was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. Here's the important lesson that we must learn as Peter and John proclaimed salvation. To strike the point home, we see the declaration of prophetic scriptures. Jesus Christ is the head and the chief cornerstone of God's building. In Jesus Christ, he's not only the chief cornerstone, but he is the foundation of every prophetic utterance that is there. Psalms 118 verse 22 says these words, the stone which the builder rejected has become the chief cornerstone. God took his stone, despised man's rejection, and still made him the head of the corner. God exalted Jesus Christ and they made him the head of life. He is the head of our life. Matthew chapter 21 verse 42 says, Jesus says to them, did you ever read in the scripture, the stone which the builders rejected, the stem has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. It is what? In whose eyes? In our eyes. Jesus Christ alone saves. There's no other head, no other one that is exalted than Jesus Christ. No man can be saved from his sin without using the name of Jesus Christ. And I believe you and I, if we're going to see people saved, there's one thing that we need to do, is to stand in and declare who Jesus is. No teacher is capable enough to teach us how to be saved or how to find Jesus in exception. He understands the word of God thoroughly. There's no two ways about salvation in this generation. There's no three ways. The only way to the Father is through Jesus and Jesus and Jesus alone. These days we can do all the politicking. Every politicking, it ends up glorifying the devil. And I believe the greatest thing that we can do as the children of God is to leave everything that we do, everything that we talk, there must be the fear and the reverence of God to say, he is my everything. Before I say something, there is that fear that comes on in my mind. I don't know how many of you were saved by Jesus, and when Jesus saved you, your life changed. Because when Jesus saves you, you will not be the same person that you were before you were saved. If you find you're still, you know, dabbling into the world and dabbling into the things of God, you must know there is something that is lacking. A genuine saved Christian, when Jesus saves you, you'd rather stand before the bullet and say, Jesus is my Lord. You'd rather promote peace than disharmony. You'd rather promote the joy of the Lord and the celebration of the Lord than promote chaos. You'd rather say, it doesn't matter if there's only one person that is going to celebrate Jesus, I'm one of them that is going to be there celebrating Jesus. And I believe that's the God that I have in my heart. I don't want to look at evil. I want to look at what God made to be so beautiful. The reason why the world today we have missed the goodness of God is because we are looking at what the devil can do, and we glorify the devil more than we glorify Jesus. I wish we can start looking at Jesus and say, he is the Lord of my life. I wonder how many feel Jesus when you're in the house of God. No prophet is noble enough to prophesy the truth without the touch of Jesus Christ. No prophet. Every other prophet that is going to try to prophesy, he's going to use psychic, magic, and all kinds of witchcraft. But only when he prophesies through Jesus, you'll be able to feel the witness that this is from God. There's no being exalted above all human beings other than the name of Jesus. That's why we're here to celebrate him. For us to minister God effectively, we need to know Jesus wholeheartedly. You know, when you know Jesus wholeheartedly, you'll not get into the house of God and say, how am I going to celebrate God? You get in here and start dancing and singing before the Lord. I have come in this church, sometimes no music, nothing, and I have found myself dancing and running all over this place, and they feel like there are 20 and 50 of us here magnifying the name of Jesus. I've just come over here sometimes whereby I have sat in this place by myself, and all of a sudden I'm moved by overwhelming power and the grace of God that I can't help it. I find tears rolling down. And I just find myself, I can't say a single word, but just simply say, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. When you know that Jesus, your life changes. I wish somebody can say amen. Is this a celebration time? If this is a celebration time, I wish somebody can shout amen. Where is Tony today? Hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Well, let's give a devil a heart attack. Let's make him jealous. Let's make him know that these people right now, they have put what was bothering them yesterday, what is bothering them before they walked in here, they are here to celebrate Jesus Christ. If something bothered you, put it aside, push it away, and say, I'm here to celebrate Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Somebody shout hallelujah. I don't know about you, but whenever I come in the presence of God, I forget about my problems. I forget about what nearly killed me. I start celebrating Jesus. I mean, I can come before death in a minute, but once I'm in the presence of God, forget about it. And just magnify the name of Jesus. How many are ready to worship God? You know, one of these fine days, I'm going to tell Jack to say, don't pray, no music. One day everybody stand up here. And I said, let's worship. And I will never hear Jack pray until we worship. And I'll let you raise your hand and they worship the Lord until we start spreading in here. But the time when we leave here, then when I see that we are real celebrating God, then I'll say, Sister Jack, now you can help us play some music. We need to get to the place whereby we are not motivated by instrument, but we are motivated by the love of Jesus. Amen. We need to be motivated. You know why most of the Christians, they backslide when a man of God does something? It's because they put their heart and their eyes on a man of God instead of putting their heart on Jesus. I saw a lot of people when in the days of Jim Baker and Jim Swaggart, when they fell because their heart was on a man of God. And the question that I preached one time, I said, the Jim Baker that backslid, or the Jim Swaggart that backslid, he never lost the anointing. It's only that he was exposed. If we never heard, we still honored them the same way how we honored them before. And because we put our eyes on them, when we heard something, we turned away. And there are so many people that left the church because they believed in men more than they believed in God. And I think for us to stand and do something, we must don't believe in David Shamenda, believe in Jesus. Stand up and say, God, I hear my pastor is preaching, but right now I'm seeing and hearing my pastor, but I'm getting to Jesus. Get into that level whereby you say, if David Shamenda is not preaching there, I'll stand firm. If my little daughter, Joanna Shamenda, comes to preach here, I'll stand and listen to Joanna Shamenda and say, praise God, I heard the voice of God. Amen. So it shouldn't matter who is preaching. It should matter how I'm ready to hear God. Hallelujah. How many are ready to hear God today? Amen. The question comes, how am I going to impact my community and serve Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior to be great soul winner? This is what I say myself. I'm saying, please, Lord, grant me wisdom and the favor to win souls here in Buffalo around the world for your name's sake. That's what I say. Moses said, if you don't go before me, I'm not going anywhere. That's what Moses said. But what do you say? Abraham said, the Lord will provide when they cut it, no sacrificial lamb. He says, Daddy, whenever we go to the mountain, you cut something, what is happening now? And the father says, baby, God will provide. What do you say? I think there must come a time where we agree to say, God, do something. Amen. Jacob said, if I won't let you go unless you bless me. I won't let you go until you do what? You bless me. And his name changed. What are you doing yourself? Are you going to let God go? Sometimes you come close to God and you let him go. Abraham said, God will provide. And when he laid his son, you must remember the son of Abraham was bigger. There's no way out today. I could bound Elijah and say, Elijah, lay down here. I'm going to cut your neck. Elijah would tackle me to the ground. And said, Daddy, what are you doing? Are you mad? It would be battle. But this man, he bound him. And when he bound him, he tied him and they're ready to strike him. And the Lord, he says, don't do that. For I have seen your faithfulness. How many of us are ready to see the faithfulness of the Lord? Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will save the Lord. And his household really stood in for righteousness. How about you? What do you say? Each person must have his own conviction on what you're believing God to do. This is not going to be collectively on everybody. Samuel said, speak, Lord, I'm healing. And God revealed what needed to be revealed. Nehemiah said, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And they finished the building in 52 days. David said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And he was, whenever he was before his enemy, God fought the battle. Solomon said, trust in all the Lord in all your understanding. And Solomon was the wisest man. There was no other man other than Jesus who had more wisdom than Solomon. Jeremiah said, the plans of the Lord is to prosper you above all things. And we see how God blessed him with the greatest wealth. Jabez said, Lord, enlarge my territory. And he was blessed. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, we will not bow down. And everybody knew they were exalted above everything. Ezekiel said, can these dry bones, he found the dry bones in the valley, dry bones, can these dry bones live again? And God said, speak to them. You know, when people, they say buffer is difficult, it's not difficult. It's because we have not known how to confess the words of the Lord. Dry bones, you find them in the valley. And this man, can these dry bones live again? And then it says, speak to these dry bones. And the dry bones begin to pop up. And they begin living beings. Peter said, I will cast my cares upon the Lord, for he cares. And Peter, even when he was crucified, he says, don't crucify me the way how you crucified my Lord Jesus Christ. Crucify me upside down. That it shows the commitment. These men, they were ready to celebrate Jesus. Paul said these words, but my Lord will supply all my needs according to his riches through Christ Jesus. In persecution, in turmoil, God was there. The growth of the early church is because there was brotherhood unit. They were of one heart and one soul. Ron preached a message the other time, the functioning of the body of believers. When there's brotherhood, there's no one who is above anyone. We are all workers for Jesus. Amen. When there's unit, we know that what I do, my friend, my brother can do, and we are all functioning for the kingdom of God. In my life, I've been in the ministry for more than 33 years, and what I have done, I've identified the people who have gifts without jealous, without saying, people, they should look at me. Sometimes I've pushed people in the front, and they say, let me see how far you can go and how God can reach all over the world, not only in America, all over the world. I will do that to anyone who says, preacher, I am ready. I want you to mentor me. The subject and the lessons that I have learned in these 33 years is humbling. A number of you, I can dare you to walk 2 seconds, you quit, and you never serve God for the second day. I've gone through some of humiliating, humbling process, some of them which have almost costed my life, but I still stand on. If every blood has to drop, must cry out, I love Jesus. If every ounce soul must sweat, must come out, must cry out, I love Jesus. If the devil can cut me into pieces, every piece will cry out, I love Jesus. And that's my desire when I preach to people, that every ounce of your body, every blood, every sweat, everything, every tear should cry out, Jesus. In your dream, when you are dreaming, when the devil is threatening you, you should be saying, Jesus, instead of cussing and swearing. You should cry out that God is there for you. The change to go to another level, we need oneness. Oneness. The change is not made of two people. The change is made of one person. And his name is God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The reason why there's no celebration in the house of God is because everyone is trying to exercise the authority. But when we come together and they say, God, we are one body, we are united, and that this that we are doing is not for the pure only, it's for the kingdom of God. Just imagine that the person who saved the Billy Graham, who God used. Did you know how many people Billy Graham touched? Billy Graham touched thousands and thousands of people. It's believed that when Nelson Mandela was in prison, listening to Billy Graham, he gave his life to the Lord. There are so many people that Billy Graham touched around the world that nobody knew. But everybody says Billy Graham did it. They don't know the person that was used to make Billy Graham go to church. Just imagine the person who touched the life of Smith Wigglesworth. Just imagine the person who touched the life of Reinhard Bonnke. Just imagine all these other men that you read today. Imagine when the person who touched the life of Peter in the Bible, Paul in the Bible, Jeremiah in the Bible, all these other men, the prophets that you read, it didn't come easy. Today we celebrate them, we read about them, we rejoice, but somebody spent countless hours. How many times have you been on your knees to cry and pray the blood of Jesus over someone? How many times have you even just stood there and started celebrating? When I look around here today, we have some people who belong to this church. We don't know where we are. Why can't you get down on your knees and say, God, whatever it is, I'm going to pray for them. And if I don't see them, I don't hear them, I'll call them and I'll drive to their home and I'm going to go there and say, I didn't come to eat, I didn't come to do anything, I came to pray for you. What Jesus is about. You know, going to somebody's home and they say, you know, I've come with one mission here and just bring you to Jesus. I've come with one mission here and encourage you that Jesus is the Lord of our lives. But you know, what do? And I'm bound for heaven. I'm going to see Jesus Christ. Those who are not here, it's up to them. You know, they'll find out someday. You know, there's a fire there. The fire is burning. Do you know, I heard one preacher says, the only Christian church is the only church that knows to wound the already wounded one. Christians, they rejoice when someone backslides instead of fighting for someone to come out of that backslidden nature. Christians, we rejoice when someone is failing instead of holding one another. My desire is that if this church, as we grow, you know, I'm going to make sure that we start another church. We keep on starting other churches within Bethel until we feel Bethel. Because I'm not here to make a name here that we have 10,000 strong that are coming to Home City Church. I'm here to say we did the devil number. We devastated him. We left him empty. And the devil is put to shame. Are we together today? Everybody's quiet. Are we together? This is serious. You know, we need to be in one accord. We need to be in harmony. We need to love one another with the love of Christ, not the love that is temporary. That love is called the filial. When you see a person, you smile, but when they are outside, You say all kind of atrocious thing. You can't even believe. Even if you, even yourself, when you finish saying what you have been saying, you feel embarrassed. That's what the church does these days. We need to love one another with the agape love. That word agape love means unconditional. Unconditional. That means when I see the weakness of my friend, I cover them and I do not expose their nakedness. One time I preached a message, "Don't expose me, son. God will bless you." When the sons of Noah, they went and some of them, they found their father drunk and naked. They said, "Come and see our father naked." One of them said, "No way am I going to look at my father's nakedness." And he came blindsided and he covered his father. And he looked at his friends, "Why would you do such an abominable things to our father?" Do you know we do things like that? Here's what happens when the early church believed. They believed in the Lordship of Jesus Christ. They believed in the inheritance of eternal life. They believed in the being rewarded by being faithful to Jesus Christ. They believed in denying themselves totally and saving Jesus Christ. And they forsook everything else for the sake of Jesus. And then the church grew to more than 5,000. Sister Jack, the church grew. How many believe that we can have an impact in this city if we forsake ourselves? How many believe that if we come together with one mind, one spirit, one accord, we can have an impact in this city? How many believe that as we come together, we look beyond our yesterday's mistake, we look into what we can do? We don't see what you did yesterday, we see what you can do now for Jesus. J.F. Kennedy says, "Don't ask you for what can be done for you in this country, ask you for what you can do for your country." Did he not say that? Now, if a natural president of the United States says those words, I want to say, don't ask you for what you can do for Jesus, ask him, "I'm ready to do something for Jesus." Amen. Stand for him and declare that Jesus is your Lord. Let me tell you something. When people, they walk in love, things, they begin to happen. When people, they walk in love, love sees no injustice. Love sees no evil. Love covers the multitude of sin. Love doesn't celebrate in the failing of another person. Love looks at another person who is struggling and they say, "This is my brother." Love causes the shepherd to go back into the wilderness and they get the one sheep and the left 99 and bring them. Love says, "I'm not going to talk about my brother and my sister when they are not here." Love celebrates to see others doing good. Love, just if you see someone struggling, you want to help them and they say, "I'm going to stand with my brother." That's what caused the New Testament church to grow. And that's what I believe. I believe as I am blessed, I'm going to be a blessing to those who are struggling. Because that's the reason why, God. This is the reason why I'm preaching in Buffalo. This is the reason why I'm standing at a home city church. This is the reason why I cannot go where they can pay me lots of money. I can stand over here because love tells me this is where I want you to manifest my name. Love looks at the pain of others. Love looks at the hate of others. Love looks at those who are stricken, who are wounded. Love looks at those who are dying and they say, "God, I'm going to be with them and I'm going to show them the joy of Jesus Christ." That's love. The reason why people that don't come to churches today, there's no more love in the church. There's just, "Hey, what's up? How you doing?" I think in the church of God, there should be, "You are my brother, my sister. If we join hands together, we'll stand and we'll win." Love celebrates the victory of one another. Love builds the church. Love builds homes. Love builds marriages. Love builds those that are in the homeless shelters to come out of them. just cry. When you love Jesus, you can't help it. But you just break down and say, "God, I've been lost. You saved and died for me on Calvary." Love covers the multitude of sin. Look around and find who should I love? Jesus. Dear, I pray that this message that I'm preaching today should not fall on the ground. Let it fall on their hearts. Let them know that Christianity is just talk. Talk is cheap. Christianity is reacting on the actual facts. Love changes all things. You don't put yourself to be anything. You put Jesus to be something. You say, "God, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I have so many children, but I don't think I can give one. But love gave the only." And the Bible says, "Him who knew no sin became a sinner in order that we should be made righteous." Love caused him to take the sin. When you look at the people at your working place, in your home, members of your family, what do you talk to them? Do you discourage them about God, or you tell them the truth about God? What do you see? Do you really open your heart and say, "If Jesus was going to walk in here today and he looked at you, would you say, you think Jesus will say, 'Well done, my faithful servant. Everything that came out of your mouth was a blessing'?" Last night, I sat down and started thinking. I was watching TV, and all of a sudden I broke down and began to cry. I heard the voice of the Lord say, "Men who says, 'Lord, Lord, Lord,' I'll say, 'Away from you. For I never knew you. Everything that you did to please yourself, but not me.'" And all of a sudden, my heart was broken. And I knelt down and I said, "God, on that day, please don't cast me out. Let my love for you be real." I said, "Lord, I don't want to hear when you look at me to say anything that I did was just nothing but in vain." How many of us today, we have never known the truth about Jesus Christ? We know who he is, but we don't carry the love. How many people have you spoken about Jesus and celebrated him and speak about Jesus with joy and pride? The reason why we have empty churches is because there are people that are not so celebrating God, and they are not telling everybody what God has done. If God has done something to you, you tell the world. You tell the world. You tell the world. You tell the world what he has done for you. You tell the world. I'm ready to walk from here to Africa on foot. If it costs me to take the world, to tell the world, I'll do that. I'm ready to preach this gospel, and finally I die to be with him. That's my heart desire. There's nothing that impresses me anymore than loving Jesus and celebrate the goodness of God. How many are hungry for Jesus this day? You say, preacher, I want to have a heart that one day when I walk in heaven, he will not cast me away. Please raise your hand. Hallelujah. All those who have raised your hand, please just stand. My heart is crying out. Have thy own way, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to see the love of God. I want to see lives saved, changed. I want to see. If I can be with a person for 2 minutes, I want them to know that Jesus is Lord.